The views expressed on this program are not necessarily the views of Lexington Community Radio or its board of directors. The views expressed are solely those of the programmers.
You are listening to Off the Cuff. Now, here's your host, Adam Banks.
Welcome, everybody, to Off the Cuff. I am Adam Banks coming at you live from Lexington, Kentucky. Thank you for listening to the show, and thank you for tuning in to WLXU 93.9 FM. In addition to listening to us on the radio, you can check out our Facebook live stream at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks, or you can download the RadioLex app on your smartphone device to listen to us anywhere in the entire world. Amber Turner and I are both broadcasting from the Deborah Hensley Studios here at RadioLex on North Limestone. Amber, how are you doing today?
I'm good. It's a beautiful day, too, so...
Beautiful day. I'm regretting wearing these big, long pants that I have on.
Yeah.
I hardly ever wear pants in the summer, but for some reason, I decided to choose today, an 84-degree day, to wear pants.
Well, I think it was originally supposed to be kind of cooler this week, wasn't it?
I thought so.
Yeah. Obviously, with your choice of pants.
I don't know what happened there, but... It's good to be back here live on the air. Amber, have you gotten a chance to watch any of the 2020 Summer Olympics? And no, that was not an error. We are having the 2020 Olympics in 2021 due to the postponement of the Olympics last year. But have you got a chance to watch any of those wild Olympic competitions?
I've caught a few.
Well, I've not really caught that many.
Yeah.
Unless I'm at the dentist sitting in the waiting room or I'm walking past the TV in public. That's the only time I'm seeing the Olympics on the air.
Now, have you not been on social media for the last 3 weeks?
I don't get on social media that much. As much as that might be hard to believe, I really don't stay on social media. Not watch much of it. But the Olympics, it's been happening since July 23rd, and it will end on August the 8th, just a couple of more days. It's being held in Tokyo, Japan, and it's largely being held behind closed doors with no public spectators due to the state of emergency that everybody has been in over the last 18 months. But so far, Amber, China has the most gold medals with 34. China is ranked number one overall so far, the country that's ranked number one.
Wow.
They've got 34 gold medals, silver, 24 silver, 16 bronze, which brings their total to 74.
Mm-hmm.
And then you got the United States, 29 gold, 35 silver, 27 bronze. And then Japan has 22 gold, 10 silver, 14 bronze. So your bronze is... So, is gold your best?
Yes, gold is number one.
So, gold's... Okay, so that's why China is still in ahead. Even though we've got more medals than everybody else. We've got 91. We don't have enough gold.
Gotta have that gold, baby.
We gotta have some gold.
Uh-huh.
And I don't know. I've not really been reading up much on the Olympics, but I did see a story that cracked me up.
Oh.
Apparently, this woman won a medal, and the mayor of the city in Japan, I think the city of Nagoya, the mayor decided to take this woman's gold medal and bite down on her medal because that's what a lot of people do when they win medals, but that's what the winner does.
Yeah.
The winner is the one that bites down on the medal, but the mayor took this woman's medal and bit down on it during this COVID-19 pandemic that we're having. Not a smart move when you're the mayor, when you've constantly been reminded every day that there's COVID going around, and you put this woman's medal in your mouth.
They must really value their mayors over there to have them coming to the Olympics being down there on the floor.
And you see some of the craziest games that's ever played on the Olympics. You'll never see anywhere else.
Well, the one that always got me was, I think it's a winter one, but it was always the snow bobbing or like the sledding. That always cracked me up.
That's a fun one. It's a fun one. But a couple more days of the Olympics for you to check out if you want to do that before it goes away for another 4 years. But Amber, I want to start off the show not really talking about the Olympics.
Yeah.
I want to talk about drive-throughs.
Okay.
Drive-throughs. We all go...
Not drive-through Olympics.
Not drive-through Olympics. Drive-through to get your fast food.
Okay.
We all have done it before.
I have a gold medal in that.
We all... Yes. You have gold. I might have a silver. But most people have went through a drive-through before, so we all can relate to this topic. And the reason I want to talk about this topic, drive-throughs, is because there has been this viral TikTok that has
goodness.
Been circulating. And this TikTok comes from this user named Xander. I can't pronounce his last name, but his name's Xander. And in his TikTok video, he shares a peek behind the curtain of the Starbucks drive-thru where he works.
Mm-hmm.
He reveals what really happens behind the scenes at a drive-thru. And I'm telling you, after he shared this, what happens behind the scenes at a drive-thru, it makes me really paranoid. It makes me really paranoid.
I've not seen this yet, so you're going to please have to elaborate a little bit.
Well, Xander says, he says, we can see you when you pull up. We can see your face in your car, and we can see everything, Xander says in his TikTok. So he's reminding everybody, hey, when you pull up to a drive-thru window,
yeah,
we see you.
Cool.
It's not just a box that you're staring into. And a lot of the times we do. We feel like that when we pull up to a drive-thru window, uh-huh, or we pull up to the drive-thru box to order our food, we feel very discreet. We feel like nobody can see us. That's what we feel like.
Absolutely.
But that's not the case. They can see us. There's a camera pointing right in your face. And Xander's mm-hmm. just reminding, hey, everybody, we see everything that you do. Okay? In another viral TikTok, Xander revealed that it's not just your drive-thru attendant who can hear you while you speak. Every employee in the store has a headset to hear you order, to hear your order come through. So even though you might think you're talking to one person, you might be talking to like 10 people.
Wow.
So like 10 people heard that you want a triple cheeseburger, everything on it, extra mayo, extra mustard.
10 people heard me roll up and order a bicket instead of a biscuit. That makes me real happy now.
So after this TikTok video went viral, people started submitting some other secrets that happens through drive-thrus on this website called Reddit.
Okay. Oh,
so
goodness.
I have read some of the most absolutely wild behind-the-scenes stories I've ever heard from people talking about what goes on behind the scenes at a drive-thru.
Now, don't ruin none of my favorite ones for me.
Okay, one person says, I don't think most people realize that if your car is pulled up on the sensor, that triggers the microphone. We can hear what you're saying the entire time. He says, I've heard conversations about abortion, people complaining about a long line, straight up bad-mouthing my coworkers, etc. He says, I advise you to put your window back up after you order. Because we do. We go to the drive-thru window, we order our food, and we leave our window down, don't we? And we just carry on our conversation on the phone.
No, I won't. I won't because I'm in close proximity of other people.
Oh, no. I always do. I always just assume that I'm by myself, nobody's listening to me. And how foolish of me to do that because I'm on the radio. Hello, hot mic, Adam. That's what is going on at the drive-thru. You're on a hot mic. That mic is on the whole time. So every little thing that you're saying, if you're complaining about your boss at work or you're telling your friend about an affair that you're having, somebody could be hearing you. And what if you're in a small town?
Mm.
We're lucky that we're in Lexington, and there's a good chance that we're not going to know the workers inside the fast food restaurant. But what if you're living in a small town and you're talking about some night that you had with this random girl and your girlfriend's best friend is working the drive-thru?
Oh, gosh. Well, I mean, that just makes me wonder, like, if maybe those times I was having really bad days and I would get, like, 11 nuggets instead of 10, if maybe somebody heard my cries.
Another person gets on Reddit and says, commonly heard, I hear about STIs, secret pregnancies, and embarrassing medical issues, which was all the worse given that I worked in a small town and I often knew these people.
Oh, no.
Someone else says, we don't just have mics. We also have a camera and can see people when they order. I've had people flip me off not knowing I can see them. Usually if we ran out of something, or people just calling us names under their breath. There's actually a lot of rude people, he goes on to say. Another person says, I'm in a college town, so I've heard it all. Lots of conversations about sex and drugs. Sometimes I will leave the waiting I will leave them waiting so I can listen to the rest of the conversation.
No, that's what I would do.
So another person says, we can hear everything. Every sneeze, cough, mouse fart, everything. Please do not shout at the speaker. Speak normally. Please speak to the speaker, not your steering wheel, not your passenger, not your floorboards. Also, please don't swear at us, because once we turn off our mics, then you're cussing to a box and nobody hears you. So you're basically wasting your breath. But it makes me go on to think about how many times I've said stuff that I probably didn't want out that my local McDonald's attendant heard.
I'm just kind of wondering what provokes someone so much when you go to a fast food restaurant to flip off the menu board, right, or like cuss. Like, what did they say to you exactly? Like, was it because of the nuggets?
Maybe the ice cream machine was down.
Oh, well.
We know how that goes.
Yeah, for real.
But let that be a lesson to you, folks. When you go to the drive-thru, assume that everyone can see and hear you. And I mean everyone. So behave accordingly.
I always feel like
someone's watching me,
and I have no privacy.
And with that being said, folks, we got lots more Off the Cuff coming at you live after these words. Stick with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. Amber is also in studio with me. It is August the 5th, 2021. Amber, we've done this before, and I can't wait to do it again. But did you know that on this day, August 5th, a lot has went down in the past?
I'm so excited.
We've done this segment before. We've done an On This Day segment where we have talked about the events that have happened, famous events that have happened on this day. So on this day, ladies and gentlemen, August the 5th, 2021, that's today's date, but on this day, August the 5th, throughout time, so much has happened. And I want to share with the audience what all happened on this day in history, August 5th. Amber, I specifically put this one on the list because this one has something to do with both you and I, and maybe some of our listeners in Eastern Kentucky can relate to this.
Oh, man.
On this day, August 5th, in 1956, WCYB-TV, Channel 5 in Bristol, Kingsport, Virginia, begins broadcasting.
Okay.
And I know you know that channel.
Yes.
Because Eastern Kentucky, we didn't get Lexington channels.
No.
For some reason, we didn't grow up with WLX or WLEX.
Yeah.
We had to watch Bristol, Tennessee channels. So, on this day in 1956, WCYB premiered. On this day, August 5th, 1962, Marilyn Monroe was found dead in her bedroom. The death was ruled a suicide as a bottle of empty sleeping pills was found near Monroe's body. The death of Marilyn Monroe was today. She was found dead. So, they say that she died on August 4th, 1962, but she was found on this day, August 5th.
Yeah.
Do you know anything about Marilyn Monroe?
You know, I am not a huge Marilyn Monroe fan, but I did get swept up in, you know, learning about her illustrious affair and
with John F. Kennedy.
Yeah, well, with many people, I think.
With many people. Well, she was the original sex symbol. Playboy loved her. I think she was the first person on the first cover of Playboy.
I believe so.
And she was an actress. At one point in time, people considered her the most beautiful woman in the world. I think Marilyn Monroe was a size 12 back in the day, which is funny because now, if you're not a size 0, you're not considered pretty
in
today's standards. But Marilyn was a size 12. And I'm the same way as you. Not really a big fan. I don't get it that sometimes that people are so obsessed with Marilyn. They always have like life-fulfilling quotes with a picture of Marilyn Monroe in the picture. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, where are you getting this from? Because Marilyn Monroe was not an inspiration to nobody. She was a harlot.
A harlot? You want to go there, really?
I didn't know the appropriate word to say, but
Why don't you just say Jezebel? That's what my granny would have said.
But she would go around and she just not really a good person.
Not one of admirable qualities. I think that people just like her quotes a lot of the times.
Yeah, and I think that it's because of her death that made her more famous. When you die, the more famous you become. On this day, August 5th, 1957, American Bandstand, which featured teenagers dancing to top 40 chart music hosted by Dick Clark, makes its network debut on ABC. So what's interesting about American Bandstand, that the show was a local show in Philadelphia, and it ran for years in Philadelphia as a local show, and it was so popular in Philly that they went ahead and decided to make the show national.
Well.
And it caught on, and in 1957, Dick Clark, he hosted the national version of American Bandstand. On this day, August 5th, 1976, the ABA merges with the NBA.
Mm-hmm.
So there were, back in the day, there were a basketball association called the American Basketball Association.
Okay.
The ABA. And the big teams that was in the ABA was the Denver Nuggets,
okay,
the Indiana Pacers, the New York Nets, which is now called the Brooklyn Nets, and the San Antonio Spurs. They were originally in the ABA. Well, in 1976, on this day, they merged with the NBA. It says here that one of the three teams, the Virginia Squires, went bankrupt before the merger, but the other two were rewarded with substantial payouts. The owner of the Kentucky Colonels, John Brown Jr., received a payout of $3.3 million, while the Salina brothers, owners of the Spirits of St. Louis, negotiated that many believe to be the best deal in sports history. They received $2.2 million and 1/7 of a share of each of the four remaining ABA, now NBA teams, television rights forever.
Wow.
So the best team in the ABA was arguably the Kentucky Colonels.
I didn't even know that we actually had like a national basketball.
We did, and we won the championship. We won the ABA championship, their version of the NBA championship. We won that. I believe, if I'm not mistaken, the Kentucky Colonels was the last ABA champion.
Why don't we have one now?
It makes no sense. And that just goes to show that we were competitive. People love Kentucky professional sports. So why don't we have an NBA team now? I don't know. We've talked about the Kentucky Colonels in our archives before. You can check that out in our archives. So I don't want to touch on it too much. But it makes no sense to me as to why in 2021 the NBA has not flirted with the idea of having bringing a team to Kentucky. They have before, I guess, flirted. But nothing really serious has been laid down.
Okay.
Yeah. On this day, August 5th, 2021, in 19... I'm sorry, not 2021. On this day, August 5th, in 1983, Risky Business debuts, launching Tom Cruise stardom. So, Risky Business, never watched the movie.
Not a huge fan.
Of the movie or Tom?
Kindly both.
You didn't like him dancing around in his whitey tighties?
No.
One of the most iconic scenes in cinema history.
I know it.
On this day, August 5th, in 1999, Mark McGwire hit his 500th home run today at Busch Stadium in St. Louis, Missouri. And I think about that Mark McGwire, Sammy Sosa rival from back in the day. Do you remember that rival?
I do.
It was the hit rival. Who could get the most hits? And it come to find out that they both were doing steroids. And they, or Mark McGwire was doing steroids. One of them was doing steroids, and they lost their rights of being the best hitter in the league. Deservingly so. You can't, you can't enhance your performance with illegal drugs, and that's what they were doing. But there is a documentary on ESPN called So Long Summer, and it's about the Mark McGwire, Sammy Sosa rival, and it's fascinating. But I remember that was a really exciting time to be a baseball fan back in that time, during the Sammy Sosa, Mark McGwire head-to-head battles.
Yeah.
That was fun times. And finally, I saved the best for last. I saved the best for last, Amber. On this day, August 5th, in 1914, the first electric traffic signal was installed.
Mm.
Yes, the world's first electric traffic signal is put into place on the corner of Euclid Avenue and East 105th Street in Cleveland, Ohio.
Hmm.
In 1914, on this day. In the earliest days of the automobile, navigating America's roads was a chaotic experience, it says. It says, pedestrians, bicycles, horses, and streetcars all competing with motor vehicles for the right-of-way. Have you ever been out of this country and had to travel on other highways?
Yes.
When I went to Ecuador, I had to see how chaotic these streets were in mm-hmm. another country. It's chaotic. There's no road rules. And I imagine back in the early 1900s, that's how it was here in America.
Mm-hmm.
No road rules, everybody vying for a right-of-way, everybody vying to be in a lane. But now there's rules, and a lot of that has been regulated through traffic light signals. Thank God for the invention of traffic light signals.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, that was a life-changing invention, wouldn't you say?
Absolutely it was.
And thank God for it. Our life has become a lot easier for it. And it made me start thinking about some of the best inventions that were ever created.
Mm-hmm.
For me, something that I don't know what I could do without would be a GPS.
Okay.
GPS. Thank God that a GPS was invented. Could you imagine, Amber, having to steal, pull out a paper map and look at a map when you're just trying to get from point A to point B here in Lexington?
Now, look, I'm not the best person to ask that because we love road atlases. Grew up with them. My husband and I, we don't use them.
You say
them.
We, I didn't know who we was.
Oh, Wiley, you know that's who I'm traveling with. Who else is going to drive me around? But no, we both still really like road atlases.
Interesting. Over GPSs.
Well, and, you know, long story short, one time we were going through Dallas and the GPS told us to go on a road that we had traveled when we went into town, but when we were going out of town, it had been blown up. And if we would have continued on the GPS route, we would have literally driven off of this blown up road in Dallas.
Well, I can't forget the greatest invention of all was the invention of radio.
Oh, there you go.
Yes. Think about the invention of radio. I'm more fascinated with radio than any other thing that's ever been created. That's why I do it. But yes, radio was invented, and that was invented a long time ago. Actually, the first radio broadcast was in the early 1900s as well, Amber.
Okay.
And this being Off the Cuff, and Off the Cuff being the show that it is, I have for the audience the very first radio broadcast ever.
Okay.
Ever to ever exist. And this is from 1906. Now, let me give you a backstory of this story before I play this radio broadcast from 1906. So, on November 2nd, So, in 1906, Christmas Eve,
mm-hmm.
there was some boats on the water.
Okay.
And the boats was playing music on Christmas Eve. And all of a sudden, a voice came over the music and started telling the Christmas story. Talking
Santa
about
Claus?
The birth of Jesus Christ.
Santa Claus?
No, the birth of Jesus. And they thought on the boat, people listening to those to the voice, they thought that it was God himself speaking through the radio because they'd never heard anything like it. So let's take a listen from the early 1900s, 1906, Christmas Eve. This is the very first radio broadcast. Now remember, it's not nothing special, but this is the first time that a radio voice had ever been heard. So right now they're just playing music. Imagine you're on the boat.
Titanic.
Let's not get dark.
The angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them.
And then all of a sudden, here comes
and the angel said unto
this man's
them,
voice.
Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior.
Now how cool is that?
The Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes.
And that was a live broadcast.
Not too bad.
Not too bad. And they didn't know what was going on there.
And saying, glory to God in the highest.
So that was the first actual broadcast of radio. Now, I'm going to play for you, Amber, the first national radio broadcast.
Okay.
Now, this is actually from November 2nd, 1920. Station KDKA made the nation's first commercial broadcast. They chose that date because it was election day. And the power of radio was proven when people could hear the results of the Harding Cox presidential race before they read about it in the newspaper.
Is KDKA of the Westinghouse Electric and Manufacturing Company in East Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. We shall now broadcast the election returns. We are receiving these returns by special arrangement with the Pittsburgh Post and Sun. We'd appreciate it if anyone hearing this broadcast would communicate with us, as we are very anxious to know how far the broadcast is reaching and how it is being received.
Now, how cool was that right there? Hello?
I know. Why did I pause just then?
I have no idea.
Oh, my word.
How cool was that?
I think it got me a little flabbergasted. No, my throat. My throat makes weird noises, guys, and I tried to save y'all from it.
So I just thought that being the first broadcast to ever exist, I thought that was pretty amazing. Pretty amazing.
So that was the election in November the 3rd?
Yeah, November the 2nd, 1920.
It really didn't sound too bad to be from 1920, though.
Right, I know. And then some more famous inventions. What would we do without the telephone, Amber?
Probably a lot more productive, but it is the best.
Alexander Graham Bell was awarded the first U.S. patent for the invention of the telephone in 1876. But most importantly, what about the invention of the cell phone?
Oh, goodness.
The cell phone. So back in the day, you could only make a phone call if your phone was attached to a wire. But in the 1960s and early 70s, if you wanted to make a phone call, that's how you had to do it. You couldn't just go outside and make a phone call. So AT&T was the only game in town that was really producing cell phones. But there was this man named Dr. Marty Cooper. He worked at Motorola. He decided to build a wireless mobile phone, and voila, we have mobile phones.
I wonder if that was the Zach Morris edition.
He did. The phone, there's a video circulating on YouTube. If you can find him making the first phone call. And you know who he made the first phone call to with his cell phone?
I would have no clue.
To his competitor at AT&T.
Oh, wow.
It was a total troll call.
Oh.
The first cell phone call ever was a troll call.
Now, and we wonder why we're in the state that we're in now.
And we sometimes wonder why we are in the state that we are in. But ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take a quick break. And when we come back, we got lots more off the cuff to talk about. Stick with us. Welcome back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. Amber is also in studio with me. The 2021 NBA draft is officially over, and a crop of new players will be entering the league next year. The league's annual event did start off with a bang. The Wizards sent Russell Westbrook to the Los Angeles Lakers as part of a stunning deal that formed a new big three in LA. I'm a big Russell Westbrook fan. I think he's one of the greatest point guards in the league. Now the Lakers have Russell Westbrook, LeBron James, and Anthony Davis. That's a nice big three.
Well, now you know I'm not too good at basketball, but now you know I know who two of them are.
You've heard of Anthony and you've heard of LeBron. So, well, I'm pretty sure you will hear of Russell Westbrook next year, because with that three playing, I mean, hey, that's gonna be a hard team to beat.
Well,
it's going to be a hard team to beat. But let's go over the results of the NBA draft. And now, I did post a complete list of all of the draft results on Off the Cuff's Facebook page. You can check that out at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks on Facebook. But I will go over the top five picks. Cade Cunningham was the overwhelmingly number one pick. He went to the Detroit Pistons, and he's from Oklahoma State. Houston Rockets had the second pick. They chose Jalen Green. He's from the G League. The Cleveland Cavaliers chose Evan Mobley from USC. Toronto Raptors chose Scotty Barnes from Florida State. And Orlando Magic chose Jalen Snuggs from Gonzaga. Some takeaways other than the top five picks. The Rockets, I think, the Houston Rockets, they definitely racked up this draft. I think that they are the ones that came out winners of the NBA draft because they ended up with four first rounders. So they are in full rebuilding mode after they traded off their best player, James Harden, and Russell Westbrook now. And it, well, Russell Westbrook was traded off a couple years ago, but they are in full rebuild mode, Amber. And okay, them having four first rounders, that's pretty huge for the Rockets. Let's talk about the Kentucky players that got drafted. There was only two that entered. For some reason, John Calipari did not show up to the draft. Mm. He said that it was out of his control, but he could not go. And I'll take his word for it. Calipari loves the NBA draft. Yeah. He says that's his graduation day. He says that's his most favorite day of the entire year. And I believe him.
Well, yeah.
I do think that he really does enjoy the NBA draft. So I'm not going to sit here and say, well, Cal didn't show up because he only had two guys in the... Stop. Cal would show up if he only had one guy in the draft.
At least he still had two guys in the draft.
So first round, number 22 overall was Isaiah Jackson, drafted to L.A., and then he was traded to Washington due to that Russell Westbrook situation.
Mm.
In the second round, going number 51 overall was Brandon Boston, and he was drafted to Memphis. And that's the only two Kentucky players that were drafted. But when anything like this happens, a draft of whether it be football, baseball, basketball, it makes me think of one thing, money.
Mm-hmm.
How much are these guys going to be getting paid? So I looked into it.
Oh.
Here are the estimated contracts for the first five selections of the 2021 NBA draft. Pick number one was Cade Cunningham. He is guaranteed $17.2 million.
Over how many years?
Two.
Ah.
Total value, $38
million. Whoa.
Pick number two, Jalen Green, guaranteed $15.4 million. When I say guaranteed, they've already got this money.
Mm-hmm.
His total value contract will be $34
million. Mm.
This is just 2 years, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, pick three, Evan Mobley, guaranteed $13.8 million. Guaranteed. If he broke his leg today and never played again, he's got $13.8 million.
Mm-hmm.
His total value, $30.6 million. Pick number four, Scotty Barnes. His guaranteed contract's $12.4 million. His total value is $27.6 million. Pick number five was Jalen Snuggs, guaranteed $11.3 million. Total value, $25 million. Man, I should have went into basketball.
That's a whole lot of money.
I know. Why couldn't the good Lord have blessed me with the ability to be 7 foot tall and to dunk? You tell me that.
No way.
You tell me that. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take off the cuff song of the week break. So roll down them windows and enjoy. But before I play the song, I just want to let everybody know that when we come back, we have a special guest coming into the studio to talk with us. His name is Victor Palomino. He is our station program manager. And Victor is parting ways. Victor will no longer be at WLXU. He is moving on to another job. He's moving out of Lexington, and we're going to talk about his move. And I really want to bring him in to talk with him about what he thinks of us. Me in particular. Because when I first started here, Victor was the one who interviewed me, and he was the one that heard the idea of Off the Cuff for the out of anybody else here at the station, Victor was the one that heard it first. And I'm just curious to see what his thoughts were on that. So Victor will be coming into the studio after the song. So ladies and gentlemen, roll down them windows and enjoy a throwback, a little Fly with Sugar Ray. Amber, I'm so excited. I don't think I've ever been this more excited for a guest than what I am right now, because in the studio, ladies and gentlemen, finally, after 2 years of being here with us, every time we broadcast is our program manager, Mr. Victor Palomino. Victor, thank you so
Yay!
Much for finally stopping by and being on Off the Cuff.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. It's been, like you said, it's been a couple of years seeing you coming in, doing your show, recorded, but yeah, first time. Sometimes fixing things.
So, Victor, man, you're leaving.
I am.
And, Victor, you have been a part of Radio Lex ever since I've been here. I started in April of 2019, and you were the first point of contact. You were the first person that talked to me, and you heard the idea of Off the Cuff. And you just embraced it from the very beginning, and you loved the idea. So I have to ask, Victor, am I an easy person to work with?
Yeah, no. I mean, like, we have an excellent group of volunteers here, but you are one of those that makes me happy that we have community radio, you know, because you're on top of your show, you care about your show, you try to make it as professional as you can, you know, and I know that you're having a fun time here, and you want your listeners to have fun time. So you're easy to work with. You're always on top of things.
So you've listened to this program before, Off the Cuff.
Yeah.
What do you truly think about this show?
Well, I really like the energy. I really like the topics. I mean, like, you're always kind of like looking to what's going on in the week, and then just select something to talk about, and you're always excited about it. And mostly is that is the energy and the fluidity of the show is very active. It's very upgoing, and it's off the cuff. It's what I like, and it kind of shows like that little bit of a window of Kentucky, you know, because where the energy that two of you put to the show, your accents, the way that you see things, it makes it unique.
Well, let's talk about you, Victor. So you started at Radio Lex when?
I first started here in November 2017, 18. I think it was 17, November of 17.
And how long have you been doing radio?
Oh, I've been part of community radio since like 2003, maybe 2004.
Okay, so why do you like community radio over just commercial radio?
Because of what you just mentioned. It's like I can see people walking to the door with a question, just like, what is this? I just found this. This is a radio station. Can I be on the air? And I get to see people just starting from just having an idea to creating a weekly radio show. And I think that's one of the best ways to utilize the waves, the signals, you know, the FM signal is just giving the opportunity to people to say what they want to say. And you don't find that in many, many, many places. I mean, it's like access to media right now, even that we have YouTube, we have all the social media, but access to this beautiful media that is radio can be really difficult for the regular person, you know? So that's what I love about community radio.
So your job title is station, or it's program manager.
It's station manager now.
Station manager.
Yeah, but we do, I mean, the thing with community radio is like the titles are just like something that you put on your car because we ended up doing everything.
Right. So what are some of the things for those listening if they're wondering, well, what do you do on a daily basis? Like, what are some of the things you do at your job?
Well, basically our job is just to make sure that we have radio on the air.
Right.
So I'm always thinking of working on the next day. So, for example, I just finished production for the Spanish station for tomorrow. So I know that there's going to be something on the air tonight, and I have all the shows that are going to start the thing tomorrow. So I'm always looking for content. I'm always looking to make sure that volunteers are coming here, they're doing their shows. We also make sure that since we are regulated by the FCC, making sure that everybody is doing their compliance with the FCC, and also maintaining the station, making sure that we have a place for you guys to come every week and do your show.
Well, like I said at the beginning of our interview, you are leaving us, unfortunately. It's a very sad moment for Amber and I and for the show. But so you are moving. So tell us a little bit more about that and why you decided to make this change.
Well, I'm continuing my community radio journey. So community radio brought me here. Now I'm moving to another community radio in Everett. It's in state of Washington, Washington State. That's like a 30 minutes from Seattle. I'm going to be doing the news and community affairs there. So I'm going to help the station to get connected with the community. Again, it's a station that is KSER. It's going to be my first radio station that doesn't start with a W, starts with a K. So I'm excited about that. And yeah, it's basically the decision is I do believe the community radio needs the community to survive. Mm-hmm. And we have done a great job here to take the station to the place that it is right now. There's beautiful new station that we have. There's this new studio. There's new place in the Great Line station. So I do believe that for organizations and places need change and need renovation. So I think it's a great space for me to keep moving, advancing my career in radio, and also to give the opportunity to more people to come here and increase the community part of community radio here in Lexington.
And when is your official last day here at Radio Lex?
We're still working on that, but it's definitely the last week of August of this month. So we have 3 weeks.
Where do I file my complaint to stop this move? That's what I need to know. Who's taking the complaint box comments?
You can go to radiolex.us.
Change just bothers me. It bothers me so bad because that means new bosses, and anytime you get new management, I feel like new management always wants to come in and just change things, even when it's not needed. And that just kind of concerns me because we have such a great community here. We got a great thing going. You've been so gracious to us and so nice, and I just change just scares me.
It's going to be fun. I mean, there's going to be a period of transition to whoever we hire to be here. There's going to be a time for this person to get used to the station, get used to all the volunteers. And I think it's a good opportunity to the volunteers to help that person, you know, and make them realize that they're coming to a great space where we are all a radio family. So it's going to be a challenge for that person, but it's also going to be a great opportunity for Radio Lex to become more of a community radio, because that's one thing in community radio. It's like Mark and myself, we are the ones who have the pay position and stay here most of the time. But what makes the radio unique and what it is are the volunteers, are you guys, are the voices that are out there. So I encourage you to help this person to participate more, to be more mm-hmm. present here, not only come here and do your show and then just leave and come back the next week. No, just this is a time to create that big base of community volunteers creating radio.
Well, before I let you go, I just want to say again, thank you from the bottom of my heart for just being so gracious. And I'll never forget the day, like it was yesterday, the day I met you, and you just embraced me and Off the Cuff with open arms from day one, and I'm going to miss you. Amber, do you have anything you want to say to Victor before we let him skedaddle out of here?
Oh, gosh, don't skedaddle out of here too fast. No, I just, you know, obviously what Adam said, thank you so much. You know, when I originally came to radio, well, I guess it was Lexington Community Radio then, I was not supposed to be on the air. Adam and I had just talked about me coming as a support system, and I remember you very quickly trying to run down things, I think about 2 minutes before we went live, and I was like, great, I have no idea. He just hit a bunch of buttons. But you have constantly stayed by us. You have absolutely helped not only troubleshoot things that we break or other people break, but you know, you always do it with a smile, just like you're smiling right now. You talk about the energy. You bring a lot of energy, and I think that's what we're scared that we're going to lose, is just the Victor personality that we get to walk into every week.
Thank you so much. I'm going to miss you. I'm going to miss you a lot. I'm going to definitely listen to the show in my new community. But yeah, I mean, energy transforms, so it's time to keep the transformation of energy and keep Radio Lex is what it is, you know, and I'm sure this radio station is going to continue. It's going to do great things, and it's going to be thanks to you and volunteers like you.
Well, thank you so much, Victor. We love you, and we appreciate you, and we wish you all the best in your future endeavors.
Thank you.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we got one more segment to go. Stick with us. We'll be right back.
He told me that he'd always love me. He swore that he'd never let us go.
Welcome back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. Amber is also in studio with me. Last segment of the hour.
Pretty words, but heaven only knows
Amber, did you get a chance to listen, or to watch, rather, the latest episode of The Dark Side of the 90s that's on Vice TV?
I did.
It covered the 90s TV shows, Melrose Place, 90210, Party at Five.
All your favorites.
All my favorites from the 90s. And the docuseries, The Dark Side of the 90s, it's taken an episode, it's about 10 episodes, and each episode focuses on a dark time in the 90s, and it talked about how TV in the 90s really changed for teenagers. Because back in the day, dramatic television was only for adults, but Fox in the 90s made it all about teenagers. And
then the rest was history.
And the rest was history. It took off. But good show today. Very sad that we're going to miss Victor. Victor just walked out of the studio. We might not see him next week, because I want to let everybody know that there is a chance that Off the Cuff won't be on the air next week. Might have to put on a replay. And the reason for that is because, as most of my listeners know, I am a full-time college professor, and we start school back next week. So that first week back...
Back to school.
Is back to school. A lot of meetings, a lot of professional development I got to do. So I've got to use that whole week to do that. But we will be back the next week and every Thursday after. But I'll keep everybody posted on the Facebook page on what's going on. We might be here next Thursday with a live show. So just keep a lookout on that. All right, ladies and gentlemen, that about wraps up another edition of Off the Cuff. You can follow me, the host, at The Adam Banks. You can follow Amber, the co-host, at Ambu447. You can follow Off the Cuff on Facebook and Instagram at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. Ladies and gentlemen, that is Amber Turner. I'm Adam Banks, and this is Off the Cuff. Don't forget to subscribe to our podcast wherever podcasts can be listened to. We'll see you next week from 4 to 5. Well, you'll know me when you see me, 'cause my door's painted white with my siren screaming.